Good morning. Okay, I have some announcements. And the first announcement is that there will be an IBK colloquium. An IBK colloquium is basically a lecture given by an invited guest who has something interesting to say. This particular colloquium will be on May 8, which is a Tuesday, and it will take place at 1700 hours, so 5 o'clock in the afternoon, in this room. And it will be a presentation, it will be a lecture by Peter Buckland, who is one of the directors of the Canadian very famous bridge engineering company called Buckland and Taylor. It's a company which is owned by the consulting company called Covi, which is a Danish company. Well, the lecture will be about the Lion Gate Bridge and some recent advances in suspension bridge engineering. So I can promise you this presentation will be extremely interesting. They are among the world top in bridge engineering, considering especially cable-supported bridges, okay? So I can warmly recommend this lecture to you. I have another announcement. And namely, that there's a list outside the door. And for those of you who are repetitions, so those of you who attended this lecture last year and wanted to follow it again this year, those of you who are doing that and who would like to take these small tests during this semester here, you have to sign up on this list so that we know that you will be attending these small tests. Exams, okay? For all of those who are in this lecture for the first time this year, you don't need to sign because we know that you will have to take those tests. So it only concerns the other people, okay? Any questions in this regard? And for these small tests, also in order to avoid any confusion, you are allowed to bring any material you would like, okay? The only thing you cannot bring are computers who can communicate with other computers or with the outside or with mobile phones, etc. Please don't do that. And please don't bring computers which have strange devices, which could be antennas and things like that, because it will make it very difficult for us to conduct the exam, even though that they are not working or you have switched the antenna off or things like that. Please don't do these things. It will only make things difficult, okay? So you know that this small exam is coming up. Are there any questions in this regard? Then it's probably a good time to raise the questions now, just for clarification. You have seen the tests from previous years. The tests are going to be in the same style. So basically like a multiple choice sheet of paper and a lot of exercises. They're really not too complicated. But of course, it all depends a little on how well prepared you are. Okay. Now, the last announcement before we continue and I start talking a lot about the material for today, is that we have planned a small classroom assessment exercise. So that means that together with the usual color cards you picked up entering the classroom, there was also one sheet of paper. And in this sheet of paper, there are two parts. You can fill out what you find was, say, dubious or difficult to understand in this lecture here. And you can fill out what you find was nice or easily understandable. So basically, some negative evaluations and also some, please, also some positive evaluations. And then please fill out this piece of paper during the break. And when you come back from the break, please put this filled out piece of paper on the table outside in the entrance of this lecture room, okay? Then we will study the answers in great detail, and we will try to make a statistical evaluation of the results. And I will try to present, I don't know what will come out of it, but I will try to present the results of your answers in the next lecture, okay? Maybe also, if we have time, I will try to pick out at random a couple of the answers in the second lecture today. That's basically, that was my opening announcement. Are you ready for the lecture? Okay, let's do it. So this picture here illustrates really to a very large degree how we apply probability and statistics in engineering. This picture illustrates the on the right hand side we have the real world over here, and what we want to do is we want to make decisions. We want to optimize decisions whereby we can manage the risks which we are dealing with in engineering. So we want to optimize engineering decisions, but we have, of course, the problem is that we have to do it in the real world. And in between us and the real world, when we are sitting at the desktop, when we are trying to comprehend what could be the optimal decisions, we need to operate with models. And what you see here in between here are the way we usually try to attack the problem of modeling the real world. And the details of the figure in the middle are what is being treated in the lectures we have on the seventh semester in risk and safety in civil engineering. We cannot go into the details here, but what we really are trying to do generally when we are managing risk is that, especially considering risks due to natural hazards, we are trying to model the exposures. So exposures could be considering natural hazards, it could be earthquakes, it could be typhoons, it could be tsunami events. It could also, when we are looking at normal engineering problems, as they also occur in our daily lives, exposures could be the processes leading to severe corrosion of infrastructure, like bridges. We need to be able to describe these events, and we do it in a probabilistic way because that makes it possible for us to assess the risks. But that's only the first step. We also need to assess the damages which are induced by the exposures. So the damages to the infrastructure, the immediate loss of lives when we are dealing with earthquake events or tsunamis. We need to have models taking the exposures to the damages. Now, the final step is that In some cases, the damages, the immediate damages, they can lead to follow-up events, like what we saw when the World Trade Center collapsed. Of course, the exposure was the event of a terrorist attack. The immediate damages were the collapse of the buildings and the loss of lives of all people inside the buildings and the tremendous monetary losses associated with the contents of the buildings. But the indirect consequences of that event were you can consider to be the damages to the surrounding buildings, not only the two trade towers, but also the other parts of the World Trade Center, the other many buildings which were completely destroyed, and also the infrastructure in the area, and very importantly, also the damages to the economics. So there were very large economical consequences due to loss of business, interruption of normal business possibilities, and also you saw the effect on the stock exchange market. So these in a societal context are what we call indirect consequences. And we need, of course, in order to be able to describe these, there are lots and lots of uncertainties. And to evaluate the risks, we need to also to be able to treat and describe these uncertainties and model them. Okay? So that's tremendously important. So we are really dealing with the problem of trying to establish models for these uncertainties in order to support the decision making. Now, if you look at one of the classical examples here from the domain of Switzerland, rockfall is one of the events which are always returning every year. We have a couple of severe and many not so severe rockfall events. And one of the problems as engineers we have to deal with is, of course, the safety on the roadway network. So here you see a car, which is it has been involved in a rockfall event. And what one of the options is what we can do, of course. We can install all sorts of protection structures in order to reduce the risk of rockfall. One of the ways we can reduce the risk is, first of all, we can try to secure the rock so that the rocks are not falling. The next step we can take is that we can install nets to catch the stones when they are falling. And at the last, so the last resort, more or less, is to build structures like galleries, which you have seen many, many times. Maybe you're not always realizing what they are for, but these structures are to protect you when you're driving on the roadways from falling rocks. But when we are designing these engineering measures, like the rockfall nets or the rockfall barriers, the galleries, then we need to have an idea on what we're dealing with. We need to know the parameters which are important in order to design the structures. And just to give you a feeling for that, there are two phenomena when we are dealing with rockfall which are very important. The first phenomena is the release of the rock up on the cliff. So this phenomena is very uncertain because you're basically standing there with this cliff, which is a very old thing, and it's in many cases very inhomogeneous, and the knowledge you have it is very sparse. You can make tests, you can drill holes in the cliff, but in reality there's a limit to the information you can get out of the cliff. And it takes a lot of expertise, geologist expertise, in order to evaluate, come up with some models on how much volume would this cliff release per year, and what are the sizes of the rocks falling out of this cliff. So that's extremely important, and we need to be able to assess that. And this here is one of the typical representations, so an exceedance probability curve for releases of different volumes from a certain location up on the cliff. Now, the next step is to model, okay, so we have a certain volume, it has been released, now how will that fall down? And in the end, of course, you might realize that the falling process is also subject to a significant amount of uncertainty. The rock is falling down, it's bouncing on the ground, it's jumping up again, maybe it's splitting into two or splitting into three, it's continuing to fall, and in the end, there will be a spatial distribution of the falling rocks at the location where we have the possibility to build some sort of protection. Now we need to know this spatial distribution of falling rocks at the location, and based on that, we are able to derive, for instance, the joint probability density function of the energy and the volume at any given location. And this now forms the basis for design. Design of the structures which we can install to protect you. Mind my handwriting. Okay, sorry about that. So this is one of the examples where you can very clearly see where do these probability distributions come into the picture. Why are they important? And what I also wanted to say is that the engineering problems which we are dealing with, they are always different. It's not like we are repeating everything like thousands of times. Any new engineering problem, we have to think. We have to start with basics in order to be able to see what is needed in order to develop the models which are required to support the decision making. And it's not like that there's one unique solution you can just look up into a book in order to solve these challenging problems. You need to try to think what would be the nicest way of representing my model, the nicest way, say, providing the possibility for work with as small as possible uncertainties, utilizing the informations we have in terms of data to the maximum extent. And, of course, any engineering model should be verified. So we cannot just think out engineering models and postulate them without having some sort of a fixed point whereby we can evaluate the goodness of our engineering models. So the validation of engineering models is important. As mentioned, the engineering problems, also those involving uncertainties, are very often specific or even unique. And being able to solve such problems requires basic tools. Physical, mathematical, natural sciences, human sciences, and engineering, of course. We are trying to combine all these disciplines into the decision-making process. Understanding these different disciplines also gives you an idea on what would be the appropriate way of modeling the problem in order to provide the answers which are needed in the decision context. It's not only mathematics, it's not only physics, it's not only engineering. It's trying to get an understanding from a holistic perspective. And because basically all problems, when they are real problems, of course, in some cases you can look up into a cookbook when you really don't need to think, when it's something which really has been solved like a thousand of times, you don't need to think too much. But of course, some of you will be doing this, all of us are basically doing that sort of exercises. But the good engineers who are really in need outside ETH, so the engineering practice needs really the good engineers, and the good engineers are those who are able to innovate, solve problems which have not already been solved 1,000 times before. So we need to be able to train innovation. We need to be interested. We need to really want to try to find good ways of solving problems. And that requires training. It's not something which comes for free. You really need to train the ability to be innovative. It's not something you are born with. That's a misunderstanding. You can be born open-minded. That's clear. You can train being open-minded. You can try to remember yourself, okay, maybe we should try to look at problems from many different angles instead of just looking at problems from the same angle every time. And it takes training. Training is important because it provides experience. By training, we start to realize patterns. And it's basically it's the same thing as when you're playing chess or any other game which is, say, more complex. The more you train, the more immediately you are able to overview a situation. And this is because you recognize patterns. So you recognize situations you've seen before. You recognize the possible potential of tools which you have in your toolbox. We talked about the toolbox the last time. The toolbox is very important. You need to understand the tools, but training practice provides you really with the ability to try to see in what situation would I get the best benefit out of this combination of tools. So you will be able to select the tools appropriately to your problem. Sometimes it's even possible to reformulate your problem so that they fit to your toolbox. And this is also of great value to be able to do that. So much for that. Now, coming back to the tools. The last time was really an exercise of presenting some tools, some basic understanding of characteristics of random variables, okay? And what we looked at were the expectation operator, we looked at the variance operator and the corresponding characteristics. We also looked and introduced the jointly distributed random variables, like we have in this case for discretely distributed random variables. Finally, we went over to have a look at functions of random variables, and we looked at one particular function, namely the sum of two random variables, and we looked at how could the probability density function for such a sum be established, knowing the joint probability density function of the two random variables. We had a look at more general constellations like a nonlinear function of one random variable, and we were able, based on such functions, to derive the probability density function for such random variables for the case where we are dealing with continuous distributed random variables. And the very final thing was the case where we were looking at functions of random variables. Why are functions of random variables contained in the vector x through the functions gi, and we assumed that the inverse relation also could be established, so the x's could be related to the y's through another set of function, and also in this case, and I realize I was very fast in the end of the last lecture, but we will come back to this with a small example today. Even for this relatively complex situation, we were able to establish the joint probability density function of the random variable y's expressed in terms of the probability density function of the random variable x. So these are tools. And I want you to get some training with the tools because it provides you through pattern recognition. It provides you with a very valuable toolbox to solve problems which in general may be specific in specific situations. Now, today, we are again looking at the topic of random variables. And as a part of that, I want to introduce a central limit theorem. I want to introduce a normal distribution. And I want you to see also and get acquainted with the log normal distributions. These are two very important probability distribution or cumulative distribution functions. And then we will start looking at random processes. Random processes are opposite to random variables. They describe phenomena which has a time dependency. So the random variables we have talked about up until now represent uncertainties which do not change in time. But now, because many uncertainties actually have a significant time dependency, we also need to talk about that sort of uncertainties, and we call those stochastic processes, random sequences, binomial distributions, and geometric distributions are what we will look at today, and this is relatively simple. Now, the first insight here concerns the central limit theorem. And the central limit theorem says that the cumulative distribution function for a sum of a number of random influences or random variables approaches the normal distribution. It's also sometimes called the Gaussian distribution, as the number becomes large. So if you have a number of random variables, x1, x2, up to xn, and you sum them up together, then the result of that sum, namely y, will become normal distributed, as n becomes large. There's a couple of conditions for this to be valid. So first of all, n needs to be relatively large. Secondly, none of the individual terms in the sum should dominate the sum. So it shouldn't be like x1 is contributes with 90% to y, and all the other n minus 1 random variables contribute only with 10%. In that case, it does not hold. But if these contributions are more or less of equal weight in the sum, then it holds. For the same reason, I'm sure you're discussing the central limit theorem. For the same reason, the individual components in the sum, they cannot be too strongly dependent. If there was a strong dependency between the components of the sum, it would simply have the effect that it would reduce n. So if you have a strong dependency between the random variables, in effect, that would correspond to a situation where you had independent random variables, but where you did not have as many. Okay? And then we come back to the first requirement that n should be large. Now, there's another thing coming out of the central limit theorem, say the law of large numbers, and that is that if n is really, really big, then the uncertainty associated with y goes to zero. So y would become, for a really large n, it would become a deterministic variable. There would be no uncertainty. So if you're summing up very, very large numbers of terms, each associated with uncertainty, then in the end, the uncertainty associated with the sum would reduce to zero. And that's a very nice property to keep in mind. It gives good support. Now, the normal probability density function is given as it's written here. You will see that many, many times. It's through an exponential function, and you see the parameters of the probability density function is the standard deviation and the mean value. Here you have the standard deviation again. It's very straightforward to calculate and to program. Now, the cumulative distribution function, again, the parameters sigma you see here and here, is simply defined through the integral of the density function, which is the normal definition, of course, for a commutative distribution function. But in this particular case, this integral is not very easy to solve. Okay? We can do it numerically. Of course, we can do that. But to find an analytical solution is not easy. Okay? And in general, what you will be able to find is in software tools such as Excel or any other spreadsheet, there are some functions already incorporated which you can call if you need to calculate the cumulative distribution function of a normal distributed random variable. And in those solutions, they have made some nice evaluation of this integral based on good approximations. Here you see the shape of the density function. And for this case, the expected value is 0. And here you see the corresponding probability, the cumulative distribution function. We already talked about that. Oops. Now, as an illustration, you have also in the lecture notes, you have this small example which concerns the repetition of measurements. So if you're measuring some distance and you're repeating measurements in order to measure the entire distance, then if and every time you make one measurement, there is an error associated with a measurement in the order of plus minus 0.5 millimeter. And we assume that this measurement uncertainty is uniformly distributed. Now you may imagine that we can measure distances at different lengths, and depending on the lengths we need to measure in total, we need to repeat these measurements. And in the cases where we have only one measurement, two measurements, four measurements, and eight measurements, what we can do is that we can establish the histograms corresponding to the distribution of the measurements. So, of course, if we only make one measurement, then the measurement uncertainty is uniformly distributed, as I said, in the interval plus minus half a millimeter. But if we repeat it, then the sum of these two corresponding measurement uncertainties, you see, it's already significantly different to a uniformly distribution. It's very different. And if you make yet another two more measurements, so n is equal to 4, you see that now it already now has a very nice curve shape. For n equal to 8, you can start to recognize the shape. The shape of the normal density function, this thing here. So very, very fast, meaning even for relatively small n, you see that this uniformly distributed random variable, adding up on other uniformly distributed random variables, very, very fastly converges towards a normal distributed random variable. Now, of course, also using the result from the last lecture, we can also derive the shape, so the function of the normal distribution, by summing up random variables during the convolution integral. Then we have a new random variable. Then we can sum that up with a new uniformly distributed random variable, if you like, or any other distribution. We can continue that, and this process will also lead successively to the development of the normal distribution density function. So the normal distribution function is very frequently applied in engineering modeling when we can assume that the random phenomena is composed of a sum of other random influences. So this is already one physical argument which we can keep in our back head as one of the tool in the toolboxes, and we can recognize this problem is dominated it's by influences which are summed up, influences which are uncertain. Like, for instance, the traffic volume on some major highway here in Switzerland. It's a contribution of inflowing traffic from many directions. And in such cases, it might be an idea to use a normal distribution to model the traffic flow. Again, there can be other arguments which could lead to other choices. For instance, looking at the traffic flow, if you're looking at a freeway and then you want to have the flow on the freeway, then it's clear that the traffic flow cannot be negative. Okay? But the normal distribution is defined in the interval from minus infinity to infinity. So it would allow also for negative values. And for that reason, well, it might not be the most appropriate random variable to represent that uncertainty. Now, that has to be considered in every particular case, what makes sense to use as a model. Now, if you have a linear combination, say a linear sum of normal distributed random variables, then of course also due to the central limit theorem, it comes out automatically that the sum of normal distributed random variables is also normal distributed. So the normal distribution is also said to be closed in regard to linear operations. So a linear operation on a normal distributed random variable will also be a normal distributed random variable, any linear operation. The normal distribution can also result from other considerations. For instance, concerning the distribution of energy in an isolated system. That relates to the distribution of energy and the concept of entropy from the second law of thermodynamics, which says that the energy distributed in a system will, over time, tend to be distributed such as to maximize the entropy of the system. That means it will reduce the energy available to produce work in a system. That's the second law of thermodynamics. And it's, well, of course, there are some interesting features with this concept. You see here in the first illustrations up in the right corner, you see two systems. One system where we have a separation between high energy and low energy particles. And then when we take up the separating wall in this container, then over time, the low energy and the high energy particles, they will mix together. So it's the principle of mixing, trying to to maximize the potential energy in the system, reduce the energy available for work. another aspect which is related to this is the aspect of time. So if you have here on the left-hand side, you see some particles, for instance, gas molecules, and these are the locations of these gas molecules. And now you look at the same container, but at a different time, and you see a different ordering of these particles in space. Of course, you would assume that the picture on the right-hand side would be prior to the picture on the left-hand side, because on the left-hand side you have disorder, on the right-hand side you have order. And this is implicitly the way we understand time. Time goes from order to disorder. And the concept here is that it is not necessarily so. It is not necessarily so based on normal physics. We could also go the other way around. So there's nothing in physics which, for instance, could not unstir a cup of coffee. when we are mixing sugar and milk into a cup of coffee, we are stirring it, and we are mixing it. But there's nothing in physics which say we cannot unstir a cup of coffee. So taking a cup of coffee already mixed with sugar and milk, and then we would stir it, and then we would basically get, we would get some sugar and we would get some milk clearly separated from the coffee. In physics, it's possible, but it's extremely unlikely. So the probability that it happens is simply so small that we very rarely would observe this event. So the concept of probability came in very, very early in thermodynamics in order to be able to analyze the energy in isolated systems. And one of the guys coming up with this concept was an Austrian called Boltzmann, and then later another physicist called Maxwell operated with this in the area of thermodynamics. And the concept evolved into information theory, and there a very famous guy called Shannon showed that the information entropy was actually a more general concept than entropy in thermodynamics. It's very interesting, and it really relates to the probabilistic description of information, or say energies. If you look at the accumulation of random movements, like also errors, can be considered as a special case of in a system like this. I will try to make this work somehow. Should not like that. Let's see what we can do. Arrow. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. It's very probabilistic. Well, I think I will do it the safe way. And we'll just block this. Discard. And then you can see here. Now you can see what is really going on. Up in the top, up where the cursor is, a small particle is released, and then it hits one of these small pins on its way falling down. And every time it hits a pin, it has an equal probability of going to the right or to the left. And then you can see how the distance from the center is distributed by counting up here in the bottom the number of balls falling down at the different locations. And as you might already guess from the curve, which is suggested there where the balls are piling up in a kind of histogram, in the end it will become a normal distributed random variable, so the distribution of the distance. And this concept was also very intensively studied in the early literature in Europe concerning studies related to human sciences. The statistics, when you really go back, you will realize that the statistics were mainly developed in the social and human sciences, and then later the concepts were also utilized in the area of natural sciences. So that's also quite interesting. I told you previously that the normal distribution is also called a Gauss distribution because of the famous German mathematician called Gauss. But there were a number, actually there were a large number of very good mathematicians and statisticians involved in the development of this distribution before Gauss even came into the picture. And I think it's fair to say that de Moivre was one of them. Also a Swiss guy called Bernoulli, who actually started by studying law school and then because he was interested in trying to evaluate the chances of having a fair outcome in a court trial, he started to get interest in probabilities and statistics, and so he developed into becoming really a mathematician of very significant importance. The Bernoulli family included 9 brothers, and they were all excellent scientists. So there are some very famous and strong Swiss traditions. Okay, let's stop this thing and let's respect the break. But please fill out this small note with the 2 type of questions. Okay. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope that you tried to fill out these things. What I did notice is that very many of you did not take one of these. And I wonder if you could just pass them through again. So those of you who did not fill it out, maybe you can fill it out during the lecture. Can we do it like that? Thank you. Now, due to a minor technical problem, we missed a couple of small exercises during the first lecture, but let's come back to that very fast. So, here you are facing a joint probability density function of discretely distributed random variables, x and y. And let me see. This is the start of the exercise. We are looking at a village. The traffic passing through the center is being counted by a device, an automatic device. You have seen these wires lying across the road sometimes. They're used to count the number of vehicles driving on the road. Now, of course, there is uncertainty associated with that type of traffic counting. Because sometimes, due to the dynamics of the vehicles, maybe one of the wheels is actually not really touching very hardly the ground when it's passing one of these wires. So there will be some miscounting. Also, other effects will contribute to the uncertainty. Now, what you can do is that you can go out and then you can place some poor engineer next to the device, and you can ask the engineer to count the number of cars and note up the number of cars per time unit, and then you can compare afterwards the visually counted vehicles with the automatically counted vehicles. And this is what you're looking at right now. It's the joint probability density function of visually and automatically counted cars per time unit. And we are looking at a time unit, I think, about 1 minute, 1 minute intervals. And you see that the number of cars coming on this road is distributed between 0 and 4 over 1 minute intervals. Now, the question is, what is the probability that the imprecise measurement will show the actual number, given that the actual number is 3. So the actual number is what is visually observed. And this is what we have down here on the x-axis. Those are the numbers which are correct. These are the numbers which are associated with uncertainty. Okay? Now, given that the actual number, so the correct number is 3, what is the probability that the automatic device will actually also give 3? And you have these choices. Red means 0, green means 0.07, and yellow means 0.7. Okay, thank you. I see a lot of green. I see a few yellow. Now, let's try to analyze this situation. We want the probability that y is equal to 3, given that x is equal to 3. This is what we were looking for. The probability that the measurement would come out with 3, given that the true number is equal to 3. So this is a conditional probability. And what you have here, in the histogram, or in the joint probability density function, is the joint probabilities of the different possible events. And we want to calculate this probability, and then we remember how we calculate conditional probabilities. We calculate the intersection of the two events, and then we divide it by the probability of the conditioning event. And the conditioning event here is the event that x is equal to 3. And in order to get the probability of x is equal to 3, we need to sum up over the different possibilities of the joint outcome of y. So this is why we sum up for x equal to 3, we marginalize by summing up over these probabilities, and that comes out to 0.1. And in the end, we have 0.7. Okay? Now I've tried to go back to where we were. For some strange reason, the small exercises I had prepared for you in this presentation, they were hidden. It's possible to hide parts of your presentation. But of course, that can be a nice thing, and it can be a very bad thing if you don't realize whether they're hidden or not hidden. I wonder how that could happen. Eva, I wonder how that could happen. Oh my God. Anything can happen. Okay. Now, as we I just want to say one more thing about this entropy thing. So the thing is with the principle of maximum entropy, that the distribution of the energy in the particles of such an isolated systems will, according to the principle of maximum entropy, it will be distributed according to a normal distribution. This distribution is what is called a maximum entropy distribution. And it's a very particular kind of distribution. It's a distribution which is a maximum entropy distribution for the situation where the characteristics of the particles of the system are unbounded in both directions. So there's no bound downwards, there's no bound upwards. So it can go from minus infinity to infinity. In that case, a maximum entropy distribution is a normal distribution. Now, let's look at another type of random phenomena. If we are looking at the random variable y, which is a product, not now a sum of many individual components, but a product of many random components, x's, then what we can do, and we many times encounter such products, and we would like to be able to say something about the probability distribution of y. What we can do is that we can take the logarithm on both sides, and this is what I've done here. And then you see that on the right-hand side, By taking the logarithm, we can rewrite the product as a sum. And of course, whether we are talking about a sum of logarithms of random variables, or whether we are talking about a sum of random variables, then the central limit theorem holds. So that means that the logarithm of y becomes normally distributed. And this is what leads us to the log normal distribution. We say that when the logarithm of a random variable is normally distributed, then the random variable itself is log normal distributed. And the log normal distributed random variable has a probability density function and a commutative distribution function, which I've shown here. You see, it looks somewhat similar to the normal probability density function. Here, we are not working with distribution parameters directly related to the moments. So we don't see the standard deviation, we don't see the mean value of the random variable here in the definition of the density function and the commutative distribution function, but here on this side you see how these parameters are related to the mean value and the standard deviation. Okay? So that means if you're starting out with knowledge on the first moments, mu and sigma, then you can calculate the parameters which are required to evaluate the density function and the commutative distribution function. And this is often the case. But of course, if you know the parameters, so the lambda and the theta from the very beginning, then it's straightforward to calculate the density function and the commutative distribution function. If we are dealing with a random variable, given as a product of log normal distributed random variables yi to the power of ai, and this is also a situation which we also encounter, that we can write our random functions in this way, then it's very, very nice, because the product turns out to be a log normal distributed random variables variable for which the parameters are easily achieved through the exponents and the parameters of the individual log normal random variables entering into the product. So that's a very convenient result, which is nice to have in the backhead as one of the tools. So products of log normal distributed random variables turn out to be log normal distributed, and we have a nice way of calculating the parameters of these density functions and commutative distribution functions. Try to remember that. Don't try to remember the expressions. It's not so important. You can always find it in the book. Yeah? Log normal distributions are very often applied to model uncertain phenomena, which cannot have negative values. So the log normal density function or distributed random variable is only defined to have outcomes in the positive domain. There are special variants of the log normal distributed random variable which can shift the distribution to the right or to the left, but it cannot have negative values, okay? And therefore, it's often used for also for modeling fatigue lives, steel and concrete resistances, daily river flows, and phenomena like that. And whenever, as I said, a random variable is the result of a product of several random variables. As an example, I just wanted to show you that we have the expressions for the mean value and the standard deviation related to the parameters of the log normal density function. Now, what we often have is information about the mean value and the standard deviation. And in this example here, relating to the concrete compressive strengths of cubes from the laboratory, we have evaluated that the standard deviation is 4.05. Let's imagine that. And the mean value is equal to 32.67. Now, based on this information, what we know is the coefficient of variation, which I've calculated here. And this information is very useful when we are dealing with log normal distributed random variables, because then it becomes easy to calculate their parameters. So now we can take the ratio of this to this, and you see that this term here disappears when you take this ratio. And in the end, you only have this term, which is equal to the coefficient of variation. And then you can calculate theta. When you have theta, you can calculate lambda. Okay, this is the way we normally do this. And then it becomes easy to calculate, for instance, the density function. We can also calculate the probability distribution function. Here's the density function using these data. And now if we are worried about, say, the probability that we will have a value smaller than or equal to 25 megapascal, then we calculate this using the standard normal commutative distribution function, which I will show you in just a second, and then evaluate it with this argument corresponding to what I showed you on the previous overhead. To this argument here. So we can now calculate probabilities of events which are of special interest to us for some reason. I will just jump back a few overheads because of this example I showed you. We missed one particular aspect of the lecture, and that is that we are often working on standardized random variables. And a standardized random variable is a random variable from which we have subtracted the mean value and we have normalized by the standard deviation. This is what we call a standardized random variable. Okay? And what happens is that if we start here with a random variable which is not standardized, then the standardization is shifting the distribution such that it has mean value zero, because we are subtracting the mean value. And we are normalizing such that the standard deviation of the standardized random variable becomes equal to 1. So a standardized random variable has mean value 0, standard deviation equal to 1. And when we are dealing with a standardized normal distributed random variable, then we call it a standard normal distributed random variable. And then, of course, the density function reduces to this, because now the standard deviation is equal to 1 and the mean value is equal to 0. So the normal density function looks like this, and then we call it by this symbol here. This is a standard normal density function. Yes, sorry?
But the density function in the figure does not correspond to the standard normal distribution, but just to the normal distribution.
How do you see that?
I think it is zero, but the standard, I don't think the standard deviation is that. So is it for the standard normal?
Yes.
Okay. Because you can really see.
No. But the shape you see here, this here corresponds to zero. And another interesting phenomena, which if you are really interested, you can try to investigate by function analysis, is that the location where you have turning gradient, so on this curve of the density function, in the first part here, you see the gradient will be rising. The gradient is always rising up to a certain value, and then it starts decreasing again. The location here where you have turning gradient corresponds to the location for the standard deviation equal to 1. So you can try to prove that mathematically, okay? Now we call this a standard normal density function, and correspondingly the cumulative distribution function for a standardized normal distributed random variable we denote by this symbol here. These are the standard ways of writing the standard normal density function and cumulative probability or distribution function. Okay, now we can proceed. There are many, many, many different types of probability distribution functions to model random phenomena. And here I just have taken some of those from the lecture notes. You see here the uniform distribution, you already saw that. The normal is there, the shifted log normal is there, the shifted exponential, the gamma, and then there's one I did not include, which is the beta. And there are many, many more. I mean, these are only a selection of those which we often work with. And to be able to choose the right one to work with in a given type of problem requires, as I indicated from the very beginning, mathematical insight, physical insight, insight into the natural sciences, engineering, etc., etc. And it's something which takes time to learn. We cannot take all of that in this course. Already today, you learned two very important cases, the normal distribution and the log normal. When we have a sum of many influencing random phenomena, it turns out to be a good choice to use the normal. When it's a product of many uncertain phenomena, then a good choice would be the log normal. Okay? And I also told you that the normal distribution corresponds to the maximum entropy distribution for isolated system. And for this reason, if we don't know anything about the phenomena, if we have no prior knowledge, then it's very often argued that a good choice for a distribution function which is not bounded downwards and which is not bounded upwards would be the normal distribution, because that would correspond to a maximum entropy situation, the way nature behaves. So if we don't know anything, only that it's not bounded downwards or upwards, then a normal distribution function could be a good choice from that argument alone. And the same applies for the uniform distribution and the exponential distribution. If we have with a bounded phenomena, upwards and downwards, if we're dealing with a problem like that and we don't know anything, then the uniform distribution is a maximum entropy distribution. If we're dealing with a phenomena which is not bounded upwards but only bounded downwards, then the exponential distribution is a maximum entropy distribution. And in such situations, if we don't know anything, it would be an argument for choosing such a distribution function. Now, small exercise. Expectation operator. Can you write the expectation of 1 divided by x as 1 divided by the expected value of x? Yes, no, don't know. Come on. We need more cards. This is a very, very important thing, and it's a very easy question. I see a green fraction over there. I see a little yellow reddish over here with some greens also in between. I think the majority is green, and that is a very good choice. And we try to remember that Jensen's inequality says that we cannot do that. Okay, there's no equality between these two. And whether we are getting a higher value than the true value or lower value depends on whether the function g of x is convex or concave. Actually, I think I'm going to skip that little exercise, I will distribute you the solution. Okay, but I just skipped one in order to save some time. Random quantities, in many cases, have a time dependency, which means that they can take on new values at new times, or what we call new trials. And for instance, throwing dices, you can consider that to be a time-dependent phenomenon. So we have new realizations every time we toss the dice. Now, if new realizations occur at discrete times, and they have discrete values, so discrete realizations, then we call the random quantity a random sequence. And a random sequence could be events of failure. So failure can be described as no failure or failure. So it's two discrete states. And they may occur at discrete times also. It could also be traffic congestions. If we are looking at random, say, time-varying phenomena, where new realizations occur continuously in time, so at any given point in time they can take place, and they take continuous values when they come up with new realizations, then we call the random quantity a random process or stochastic process. And examples of these are wind velocities, their variations over time, wave heights, snow levels, etc. Well, a sequence of experiments with only two possible outcomes, which are also mutually exclusive, so like failure or no failure, or getting a six by throwing a dice, or not getting a six. These are two discrete outcomes of tossing a dice. Of course, you could also split it up into many other events, but it's a discretization of the sample space of tossing dices, getting a six or not getting a six. This type of phenomena is called a Bernoulli trial. I already introduced you to Bernoulli. And typically the outcomes of Bernoulli trials are denoted successes or failures. Now, if the probability of getting a success in one trial is constant over time and equal to p, then the probability density of y, namely the y successes in n trials, this probability density function is given by this expression here, where this thing here is what we also know as the binomial operator. Which gives the possible number of different combinations of y into n. Yeah? And then, of course, what we can do is that we can integrate up this thing here, the density function. We can integrate this up, and then we get the probability, or say the cumulative distribution function. So now we have to sum up over all the possible y's, which we get here. And this is what we call the binomial cumulative distribution function. This is not correct. Cumulative distribution function, okay? And how does it look? Well, here I plotted the probability density functions for two different choices of n and the probability of success. So n is in both figures equal to 5, and the probability of success is equal to 0.15 and 0.5. And you see how we end up with fundamentally different shapes of the density function. But it's just to give you an impression that we are dealing with a density function here. And we can calculate the densities of the different possible outcomes. Now I want to come back to one of the issues we looked at the last time when we were looking at tools. Look at this small exercise. We remember that we can establish the probability density function of a random variable. Y is the function of a random variable X through this expression here, where this gradient is the first order partial derivative of the X with respect to Y. So let's see how easily that really works. If we have a very simple functional relationship between y and x, as an example, y is equal to x squared, then we can make the relation x to the square root of y. Then looking at this expression and realizing that we need to take dx to dy, we differentiate this thing here one time in regard to y, and then we become this thing here, realizing that the square root of y is equal to y to the power of 1/2. Okay? Then it's very easy to differentiate this thing. And then we can very easily write up the probability density function of y, expressed in terms of the probability density function of x. So you see, all you need to do is to get a little training in doing these things, and then you will be able to solve many different cases. Now, a random sequence, coming back, the expected value and the variance of a binomial distributed random variable is simply given by the expected value is equal to n times p. N is the number of trials. P is the probability of success in every trial. So the expected value of the number of successes is equal to n times p. And the variance of the number of successes is equal to n times p multiplied by 1 minus p. And you can easily, when you look at the probability density function, you can try to convince yourself that this is correct. Now, the probability density function for the number of independent trials before the first success is in engineering interesting, because it could give us, for instance, the time until we will have failure, the time until we will have an earthquake, the time until we will have a flood. And this is geometrically distributed in terms of the P of n. We call this the geometric probability density function. And the corresponding probability distribution function is established from this by summing up all the possible different outcomes. So this is the geometric probability distribution. You see here. Now, this is also interesting to analyze a little more in detail. But before we do that, I want to show you the final example relating to the tools the last time, namely the thing which had to go a little fast in the end of the lecture, looking at the situation where we have a vector of random variables which are defined through functions of a vector of other random variables. So the y's are functions of x's. And the functions are the gi's. And we assume that the relation between the x's to the y's can also be established in terms of functions fi's. Now, the probability density function of the y's can be given in terms of the absolute value of the Jacobi determinant, which can be calculated from the Jacobi matrix given here, and the probability density, say the joint probability density function of the x's. But look, this really, I appreciate, this looks really complex, okay? So therefore, a small example is probably very good. Look at the simple case where we have y1 is equal to x1 plus x2, and y2 is equal to x2. Y is given in terms of two very simple functions of x. Now, looking at this linear set of equations, we can easily come to the relation between the x's and the y's as well. Now, then we need to remember what is central here. We need to evaluate the Jacobi matrix, namely the quotients dx to dy. And when we do that, you need to study this side here. And then you need to take the first order partial derivative of x1 to y1. And when you do that, then you get 1 here. This is just a constant, it gets 0. So the first member of this Jacobi matrix is 1. Then the next term here, dx1 to dy2, you see the first term gets a 0, it's just a constant, and here we get a minus 1. Then in the next row, we take dx2 to dy1 is 0, dx2 to dy2 is 1. In this way, we have the Jacobi matrix. Now we need to take the determinant, which is established by multiplying this and this, subtracting this, multiplied by this. This is what we have here, so the Jacobi in this case is equal to 1. And so now it's all very easy. The joint probability density function of the y's is given as 1 times the joint probability density function of the x's. And now on the places of the x's, we have substituted their values in terms of their y's. So you see, it looked very complicated, but for many functions, it turns out to be very simple. But you need some practice in order to do these operations. Now I wanted to introduce the median of the geometric distribution, because that provides the median. You remember, it's the probability that it corresponds to the probability of 0.5 that the values will be smaller than or larger than. So you can say that the median of the geometric distribution corresponds to the number of trials which are necessary in order to have equal chances of realizing an outcome or winning a play. And if the probability of getting a realization is equal to p per time unit or per toss, then the median is immediately given here. Though that corresponds to the probability of 0.5, and we can relate that to the probability, to the cumulative probability distribution of the number of trials until a success. P is the probability of success, N is the number of trials. So, if we want to evaluate how many number of trials are necessary in a game where the probability of winning is P, in order to have a probability of winning the game equal to 0.5, then what we need to do is to, out of this expression, to isolate n. This is what we need. And we can do that very easily. Here, looking at this expression here, we need to isolate n. So what we can do is that we can take the logarithm here, And we can take the logarithm over here, and then we get this expression. Now, the logarithm of 0.5 is approximately about minus 0.7. So we end up with this expression here. Now, this is a little inconvenient because we still have p somehow involved. And I would like to isolate p a little. So I can use the result that the logarithm of 1 minus p, so you know that the logarithm, the natural logarithm around 1 is very close to 0. And in the very near range of 1, we can get a very nice expression for the behavior of the function, the logarithm of 1 minus p. And there are some exact results in terms of sums. It's this one here. That gives us the exact result, only the problem is that it goes to infinity. But if you look at this sum, and you assume that we have small p, so the probability of success is relatively small, then only the first few terms will contribute to the sum, so we don't need to sum up to infinity. In reality, it's a very good approximation for small p only to use the first term, and the first term is equal to minus p. And then we get this relation here. So n can be isolated as being equal to 0.7 divided by p. This is the number of trials we need. Now we can apply this result. So for instance, if we want to have a 50% chance, we had this exercise in the first lecture, if we want to have a 50% chance of getting a 6 in tossing dices, how many tosses do we need? A 50% chance of getting a 6. In order to do that, you have 0.7 multiplied by 1 divided by p, which is equal to 6, 4 tosses. Okay? If you want to have a 50% chance of getting 2 sixes in 2 throws, what is the probability of getting a 6 in 1 throw? It's 1 divided by 6. The probability of getting 2 sixes would be 1 divided by 36, so the probability p is equal to 1 divided by 36, so 0.7 multiplied by 1 divided by 1, say, divided by p is equal to 36 here, and that gives you 25 tosses in order to have an equal chance of getting 2 sixes. 25 tosses. Now, interesting also is that if we are concerned about the probability of observing an earthquake of a certain magnitude at a certain location, then we can now deduce based on this result here the number of years we would have to wait in order to have a 50% chance of seeing such an earthquake at a given location if we know the probability per annum that this earthquake would occur. So if the annual probability of seeing this earthquake is equal to 0.001, then 0.7 divided by p corresponds to 0.7 multiplied by 1,000, so that would mean we would have to wait 700 years to have an equal probability, so 0.5 probability of seeing this earthquake. Please remember that the median is not the same as the expected value. Yeah? And if we are dealing with the expected value of a geometrically distributed random variable, then it's simply equal to 1 divided by p. And looking at the earthquake, 1 divided by p would be equal to 1 divided by 0.001, which would correspond to 1,000 years, okay? So that is also what we call the return period, 1 divided by p, the expected value of the time until an event will happen, 1 divided by p. And this is a common name, not only for earthquakes, but for many other phenomena with a time variation. The return period when tossing dice, the return period of getting a 6 would be 1 divided by 6, so it would be equal to 6. 6 tosses. So, thank you for your attention today. We managed to cover the whole material today, and I hope that many of you who did not fill out the sheets until the break have had a chance to fill out the sheets here during the second lecture. I would like you to put down your answers here on the desk before you leave. Thank you.